Hello, welcome to the Hurricane Utah Adult Religion Class, sponsored by the Hurricane Utah North Stake of the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints. I'm Mike Parker, the course instructor. The Hurricane Utah Adult Religion Class meets on Thursday evenings between September and May to discuss the scriptures of the restored Church of Jesus Christ. If you live in or are visiting the Hurricane St. George area, I'd love to have you join us. The time and location are available on the class website. Links to the class website are available in the show notes for this video. On the website, you can download my notes, which includes footnotes documenting my sources, this PowerPoint slide presentation, and the handouts that I distribute in class. Please note that this YouTube channel and the class website are not official sites of the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints, the Hurricane Utah North Stake, or any other church unit or department. I alone am responsible for these sites and the materials on them. If you enjoy this lesson, please click the like button and subscribe to this channel to be notified when weekly lessons are posted. And if you find this information useful, please share it with a friend. In this lesson, we'll be studying the book of 4th Nephi and the Book of Mormon, chapters 1-7. The key individuals in this lesson are Nephi the third, son of Nephi the second, and one of the Nephite disciples of Jesus Christ. Nephi the fourth, son of Nephi the third, and keeper of the sacred records after his father. Amos the first, son of Nephi the fourth, and keeper of the sacred records after his father. Amos the second, son of Amos the first, and keeper of the sacred records after his father. Amaron, son of Amos the first and brother of Amos the second, keeper of the sacred records after his brother. Mormon the second, a descendant of Nephi the first, leader of the Nephite armies and keeper of the sacred records after Amaron. Aaron the fourth, king of the Lamanites in Mormon's time. Lastly, Moroni the second, son of Mormon, a military leader, and keeper of the sacred records after his father's death. The outline of events for this lesson. After 167 years of righteousness, peace, and prosperity, Nephite civilization again declined and then collapsed. Mormon introduced himself and described the events of his youth. Mormon led the unrighteous Nephite armies in a failed defense against the armies of the Lamanites. Mormon stood by and witnessed the Lamanite armies overrun the Nephites. Mormon led the Nephite armies one last time. The Nephites were utterly destroyed. Finally, Mormon left a farewell message to his people. The events in this lesson took place in the land of Zarahemla, in the land southward, and in the land of desolation, north of the narrow pass between the land southward and the land northward. These events began at the end of the 34th year after the signs of the birth of Christ, circa AD 31, and they concluded in the 384th year, circa AD 375. Recapping from our previous lessons, the resurrected Jesus Christ appeared and ministered to the descendants of Lehi in the land Bountiful. He taught his doctrine and his gospel, healed the sick and disabled, ministered to children, and organized his church. He also called 12 disciples and granted 3 of them the power to tarry on the earth until his second coming. The short book of 4th Nephi covers a period of 286 years in just 1,960 words. During this time, 4 authors kept the sacred record on the large plates of Nephi. They were the last in a long line of descendants of Alma the first. This concluded the record kept on the large plates of Nephi, which Mormon abridged onto his own plates before writing his own record. 2 years after Jesus' appearance in the land of Bountiful, the descendants of Lehi were all converted unto the Lord upon all the face of the land. They experienced an era of peace, justice, and social and economic equality, and they were all made free and partakers of the heavenly gift. They were not divided into Nephites and Lamanites, but they were in one, the children of Christ. Jesus' 12 disciples performed great miracles. The people prospered and rebuilt the cities that had been destroyed in the tempests that had occurred at Christ's death. They became an exceedingly fair and delightsome people. Mormon declared that surely there could not be a happier people among all the people who had been created by the hand of God. Jesus' disciples eventually died, all except for the three whom he had permitted to remain. Other disciples were ordained in their stead. 76 years after Christ's appearance, the first generation from Christ had passed away, and there was no contention in all the land. In the second generation, Nephi the fourth died, and the plates of Nephi passed to his son, Amos the first. The first indications of trouble appeared during Amos's lifetime. A small part of the people revolted from the church and took upon them the name Lamanites. Amos I died and passed the record to his son, Amos II. By the 200th year, the second generation had almost all passed away. The people had multiplied and spread upon all the face of the land and had become exceedingly rich because of their prosperity in Christ. At the start of the third generation, pride and materialism had increased to the point that the people stopped practicing the law of consecration and separated into different economic classes. Many churches were built to get gain. They claimed to know Christ, yet they did deny the more parts of his gospel. One particular false church persecuted the true church of Christ and the three Nephite disciples. The people did dwindle in unbelief and wickedness from year to year. In the 231st year, there was a great division among the people into two factions. Believers in Christ were called Nephites, which included Jacobites and Josephites and Zoramites, while they who rejected the gospel were called Lamanites and Lemuelites and Ishmaelites. Mormon ascribed this division to wickedness and abomination. The Lamanites did not dwindle in unbelief, but they did willfully rebel against the gospel of Christ. The Lamanites were taught to hate the children of God. Only 13 years later, wicked people outnumbered those who were righteous. By the 260th year, the secret oaths and combinations of Gadianton had returned, and the Nephites were becoming proud and vain. The three Nephite disciples began to sorrow for the sins of the world, as Christ had foretold they would. By the 300th year, the Nephites and Lamanites were both equally wicked. Gadianton robbers had spread over all the face of the land, and only the few remaining disciples of Jesus were righteous. Amos II died, and the sacred records passed to his brother, Amaron, who, 15 years later, hid them for safekeeping. The stage had been set for the final downfall of the Nephite people. We have finally arrived at Mormon's own record. After he finished abridging the plates of Nephi onto his own set of plates, he began an account of his own life. Mormon was about 10 years old when Amaron had hidden the sacred records. Amaron perceived Mormon to be a sober, that is to say serious or solemn, child and quick to observe. He commanded the boy to go to the hill Shim in the land Antum when he was 24 years old. There he was to retrieve the large plates of Nephi, leaving the other records there, and continue recording the history of the Nephite people. When Mormon was 11, his father carried him south to the land of Zarahemla. In that same year, war broke out between the Nephites and the Lamanites. After a number of battles, the Lamanites withdrew their design, and there was peace in the land for 4 years. Wickedness prevailed among the Nephites to such a degree, though, that the three disciples of Jesus were taken away, miracles and spiritual gifts ceased, and the Holy Ghost did not come upon any because of their wickedness and unbelief. At the age of 15, Mormon was visited of the Lord and tasted and knew of the goodness of Jesus. He tried to teach the gospel to his people, but they were so wicked and rebellious that the Spirit forbid him from preaching. The prophecy of Samuel the Lamanite that the land would be cursed and the people's riches become slippery was fulfilled, and the power of the evil one was wrought upon all the face of the land. Later that same year, war recommenced between the Nephites and the Lamanites. Mormon, at age 15, was appointed as leader of the Nephite armies. Because of his selection at such an early age, it's likely that Mormon's family was politically connected, and that Mormon had been formally trained from childhood in military tactics and strategy. This could explain why Amron, who kept the Nephite records in an official capacity, singled out the young Mormon to take over as record keeper. 2 years later, the Lamanite armies attacked with such overwhelming force that the Nephites were terrified, refused to fight, and began to retreat toward the land northward by way of the west coast. The Nephites were driven from the fortified city of Angola, and also driven from the land of David. Over the next 3 years, Mormon's forces gathered the Nephite people to the land of Joshua, which was full of robbers and Lamanites, blood and carnage. Despite their desperate circumstances, the Nephites did not repent. The Lamanite king Aaron brought his army of 44,000 against the Nephites' 42,000. Mormon's army was victorious, and the Lamanites fled from before them. At this point, there is a 14-year break in the narrative. During this time, theft, robbery, murder, and witchcraft became so bad that the Nephites began to repent. Mormon took hope that they might turn to righteousness again, but, he lamented, "This my joy was vain, for their sorrowing was not unto repentance because of the goodness of God, but it was rather the sorrowing of the damned, because the Lord would not always suffer them to take happiness in sin." The Nephites did curse God and wish to die. Nevertheless, they would struggle with the sword for their lives. The day of grace was passed from them, and thousands of them were hewn down in open rebellion against their God and heaped up as dung upon the face of the land. In the 345th year, the Nephites were forced to abandon the land southward and flee to desolation, the land northward. They retreated as far as the land of Jashon, which was near the hill Shim, where Mormon retrieved the plates of Nephi as Amron had commanded him. Mormon made a full account of all the wickedness and abominations of his people on the plates of Nephi, but he only gave a brief account of these things on his own set of plates, from which the Book of Mormon was translated. We later learn in Moroni chapter 9 that the Nephites' abominations included the rape and torture of Lamanite women, then killing them and eating their flesh. That same year, the Nephites were driven further north to the land of Shem. They gathered their remaining people to the city of Shem and fortified it against attack. In the following year, Mormon encouraged his people to stand boldly before the Lamanites and fight for your wives and their children and their houses and their homes. The Nephites took courage from his appeal, and over the next 4 years, they pushed the Lamanites and the Gadianton robbers back to the narrow neck of land that divided the land northward from the land southward. The two factions entered into a treaty in which they agreed that the Nephites would occupy the land northward and the Lamanites the land southward. The Nephites took advantage of this time of peace to fortify themselves against further attacks. Mormon preached repentance to his people, but they only hardened their hearts against the Lord. After 10 years of peace, the Lamanite king sent a declaration of war to Mormon. Mormon gathered his armies at the narrow pass to stop the Lamanite invasion. In the next 2 years, the Nephites beat back two Lamanite attacks. The Nephites began to boast in their own strength and began to swear before the heavens that they would avenge themselves of the blood of their brethren. They also swore by the heavens and also by the throne of God and by all that had been forbidden by the Lord that they would go into the land southward on an offensive campaign against the Lamanites. After loving and praying for his people with all his heart, and three times delivering them from their enemies, the voice of the Lord declared to Mormon his law against taking vengeance, and told him, "Because this people repented not after I had delivered them, behold, they shall be cut off from the face of the earth." Because of this, Mormon did utterly refuse from this time forth to be a commander and a leader of this people because of their wickedness and abomination. He instead intended to stand as an idle witness to manifest unto the world the things which I saw and heard. At this point, Mormon stepped away from the narrative to briefly give a four-point statement of purpose written to the Gentiles, the tribes of Israel, the remnant of the Nephites in the last days, and to all the ends of the earth. Mormon chapter 3, verses 17 through 22. Quote, "Therefore I write unto you, Gentiles, and also unto you, house of Israel, when the work shall commence, that ye shall be about to prepare to return to the land of your inheritance. Yea, behold, I write unto all the ends of the earth, yea, unto you, 12 tribes of Israel, who shall be judged according to your works by the 12 whom Jesus chose to be his disciples in the land of Jerusalem. And I write also unto the remnant of this people, who shall also be judged by the 12 whom Jesus chose in this land, and they shall be judged by the other 12 whom Jesus chose in the land of Jerusalem. And these things doth the Spirit manifest unto me. Therefore I write unto you all. And for this cause I write unto you, that ye may know that ye must all stand before the judgment seat of Christ, yea, every soul who belongs to the whole human family of Adam. And ye must stand to be judged of your works, whether they be good or evil. And also that ye may believe the gospel of Jesus Christ, which ye shall have among you. And also that the Jews, the covenant people of the Lord, shall have other witness besides him whom they saw and heard, that Jesus, whom they slew, was the very Christ and the very God. And I would that I could persuade all ye ends of the earth to repent and prepare to stand before the judgment seat of Christ." Unquote. In summary, Mormon's four-point statement of purpose in writing this account was to tell his readers in the last days, first, Christ will judge all people. Second, we must believe the gospel of Christ. Third, the Jews in the last days will have another witness that Jesus is Christ and God. This is a reference to the Book of Mormon. Fourth, all must repent and prepare to stand before Christ. The year after Mormon stood down as their leader, the Nephites went on an offensive campaign against the Lamanites in the land southward. Their attack failed, and they were beaten back. Wounded and weary, they were unprepared for the Lamanite counteroffensive, and the Lamanites took the city of Desolation. The defeated Nephites fled to the city of Teancum by the seashore. Mormon blamed the defeat on the Nephites' unrighteous decision to go on the offensive, declaring that, quote, "It was because the armies of the Nephites went up unto the Lamanites that they began to be smitten. For were it not for that, the Lamanites could have no power over them. But behold, the judgments of God will overtake the wicked, and it is by the wicked that the wicked are punished. For it is the wicked that stir up the hearts of the children of men unto bloodshed." Unquote. That was Mormon chapter 4, verses 4 through 5. The next year, the Lamanite army attacked the Nephites at the city of Teancum. The Nephites repelled the Lamanite attack, and, boasting in their own strength, also retook the city of Desolation. Mormon lamented that there had been thousands slain on both sides of these battles. Because the Nephites repented not of the evil they had done, but persisted in their wickedness continually, 3 years later, the Lamanites recaptured the city of Desolation and also took the city of Teancum. In this engagement, the Lamanites did take many prisoners, both women and children, and did offer them up as sacrifices unto their idol gods. Mormon lamented these horrific events. Mormon chapter 4, verses 11 and 12, quote, "And it is impossible for the tongue to describe, or for man to write a perfect description of the horrible scene of the blood and carnage which was among the people, both of the Nephites and of the Lamanites. And every heart was hardened, so that they delighted in the shedding of blood continually. And there never had been so great wickedness among all the children of Lehi, nor even among all the house of Israel, according to the words of the Lord, as was among this people." Unquote. Later that same year, the Nephites, with exceeding great anger, drove the Lamanites out of their lands and maintained them for 8 years. In the 375th year, an innumerable host of Lamanites came against the Nephites. Mormon explained that this was the beginning of the end for the Nephites, for from this time forth did the Nephites gain no power over the Lamanites, but began to be swept off by them as dew before the sun. The Lamanites captured the Nephite cities of Desolation and Boaz, and the Nephites were routed, driven, and slaughtered with an exceedingly great slaughter. Nephites in all towns and villages fled from before the Lamanite army. Mormon, seeing that the Lamanites were about to overthrow the land, went to the hill Shem and gathered up all the records Amoron had hidden there. Faced with the increasing likelihood that his people would be exterminated, Mormon recanted the oath he had made 17 years earlier to no more lead the Nephites in battle. They gave him command of their armies again, trusting and believing that he could deliver them from the Lamanites. Mormon was without hope, though, for he saw that the Nephites repented not of their iniquities, but did struggle for their lives without calling upon that being who created them. The Nephites managed to hold off the Lamanites for a brief time at Jordan and other nearby cities, but in the year after Mormon resumed his command, they were forced to flee again in the face of overwhelming Lamanite numbers. Nephites who did not gather with the main body were destroyed by the Lamanites, and their towns and villages and cities were burned with fire. Seeing that the end was near, Mormon wrote a message to his readers in the last days. He had written only a small abridgment of the awful scene of blood and carnage he had witnessed, daring not to give a full account of the things which I have seen, that ye might not have too great sorrow because of the wickedness of this people. He wrote to the descendants of the wicked Nephites and to the Gentiles in the last days, knowing that they will sorrow that this people had not repented, that they might have been clasped in the arms of Jesus. Mormon's writings were to be hid up unto the Lord, that they may come forth in his own due time in the last days. He wrote first unto the unbelieving of the Jews, to persuade them that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of the living God, that the Father may bring about, through his most beloved, his great and eternal purpose, in restoring the Jews, or all the house of Israel, to the land of their inheritance, which the Lord their God hath given them unto the fulfilling of his covenant. He next wrote to the seed of this people, the descendants of the wicked Nephites who had defected to the Lamanites, that they may more fully believe Christ's gospel, for they shall be scattered and shall become a dark, a filthy, and a loathsome people beyond the description of that which ever hath been amongst us, yea, even that which hath been among the Lamanites, and this because of their unbelief and idolatry. They were once a delightsome people, led by the Father and the Son, but by Mormon's time they were led about by Satan as a vessel is tossed about upon the waves, without sail or anchor, or without anything wherewith to steer her. The Lord would transfer their blessings to the Gentiles, and the Gentiles would scatter them, until he remembers the covenant he made with Abraham's descendants. Mormon's prophecy that the degenerate Nephites would become more dark, filthy, and loathsome than the Lamanites is another indication that these terms were not meant to describe skin color, but rather spiritual condition. The Book of Mormon describes those who were righteous as white, fair, delightsome, and pure, regardless of their tribal affiliation. Finally, he wrote to the Gentiles, with whom Mormon pleaded that they would repent and humble themselves, lest God shall come out in justice against you. In the 384th year, Mormon wrote to the Lamanite king and told him that he intended to gather all the remaining Nephites to the hill Cumorah in the land Cumorah, where they would make their last stand. Cumorah was in a land of many waters, rivers, and fountains, and here, Mormon wrote, we had hoped to gain advantage over the Lamanites. By the end of that year, the Nephites had gathered in all the remainder of our people unto the land of Cumorah. Knowing that this was to be the end of his people, Mormon, who was 74 years old at this time, hid up in the hill Cumorah all the records which had been entrusted to me by the hand of the Lord, save, or except, it were these few plates, that is to say, the plates of Mormon, which I gave unto my son Moroni. The Lamanites marched on the hill Cumorah. The Nephites were filled with that awful fear of death which fills the breasts of all the wicked, and every soul was filled with terror because of the greatness of the Lamanite numbers. Mormon's division was cut down, and Mormon himself fell wounded among them. At the end of that day of battle, 23 divisions of Nephites had fallen, and only 24 Nephites remained alive, Mormon and his son Moroni among them. Mormon's soul was rent with anguish because of the slain of my people. In his agony, he wrote a lament for his fallen people. Mormon chapter 6, verses 17 through 22, quote, O ye fair ones, how could ye have departed from the ways of the Lord? O ye fair ones, how could ye have rejected that Jesus who stood with open arms to receive you? Behold, if ye had not done this, ye would not have fallen. But behold, ye are fallen, and I mourn your loss. O ye fair sons and daughters, ye fathers and mothers, ye husbands and wives, ye fair ones, how is it that ye could have fallen? But behold, ye are gone, and my sorrows cannot bring your return. And the day soon cometh that your mortal must put on immortality, and these bodies which are now moldering in corruption must soon become incorruptible bodies, and then ye must stand before the judgment seat of Christ, to be judged according to your works. And if it so be that ye are righteous, then are ye blessed with your fathers who have gone before you. Oh, that ye had repented before this great destruction come upon you. But behold, ye are gone, and the Father, yea, the eternal Father of heaven, knoweth your state, and he doeth with you according to his justice and mercy. Unquote. Shortly before his death, Mormon wrote a coda, or afterword, unto the remnant of this people, the Nephites, who are spared. He told them that they were a remnant of the house of Israel. He encouraged them to repent so that they might be saved and to lay down their weapons of war and delight no more in the shedding of blood, and take them not again, save it be that God shall command you. He commanded them to come to the knowledge of your fathers, and repent of all your sins and iniquities, and believe in Jesus Christ that he is the Son of God, that he died and was resurrected to bring to pass the redemption and resurrection of all mankind, and that he that is found guiltless before him at the judgment day hath it given unto him to dwell in the presence of God in his kingdom. He commanded them to repent and be baptized in the name of Jesus and lay hold upon the gospel of Christ, which is in the Bible and in the Book of Mormon. Mormon chapter 7, verse 9, quote, "For behold, this," the Book of Mormon, "is written for the intent that ye may believe that," the Bible. "And if ye believe that," the Bible, "ye will believe this," the Book of Mormon, also. "And if ye believe this," the Book of Mormon, "ye will know concerning your fathers, and also the marvelous works which were wrought by the power of God among them." Unquote. Mormon concluded his record by reminding his people that they were a remnant of the seed of Jacob, the Old Testament patriarch, and numbered among the people of the first covenant the Lord made with Abraham. "If they would choose to believe and be baptized, it shall be well with you in the day of judgment." Amen. I'd like to end this lesson by reviewing some of the key messages found in Mormon chapters 1 through 7. The importance of record-keeping in history. Mormon's role as record-keeper highlights the significance of preserving history and the teachings of the prophets for future generations. The consequences of wickedness. As the Nephites fell deeper into wickedness, the consequences of their choices became more severe. Mormon wrote about the tragic outcomes of turning away from God, and he illustrated the principle that choices have consequences, both individually and as a society. War and the human condition. Mormon's descriptions of war and its devastating effects not only recount historical events, but also serve as a somber reminder of the human capacity for violence when righteousness is abandoned. His narrative invites us to reflect on the value of peace, love, and turning to God to resolve conflicts. The call to repentance and potential for change. Despite the grim circumstances he was in, Mormon's repeated efforts to call his people to repentance demonstrate the enduring opportunity for change. It's a powerful reminder that no matter how far we've strayed, the path of repentance is always open if we choose to seek it. The power of faith and the atonement of Jesus Christ. Even in the midst of destruction, the promise of the atonement offers hope. Mormon's farewell exhortation in chapter 7 is particularly powerful as a testimony of the central role Jesus Christ should play in our lives. That concludes this lesson. If you enjoyed it, please click the thumbs up button and leave a comment below. Please subscribe if you'd like to be notified when new lessons are posted to this channel, and visit www.huarc.org to download these notes and this slideshow. Next week, we'll study the history of the Jaredite people as abridged by Moroni onto his father's plates. We're going to focus on the story of the Jaredites and save Moroni's extended commentary in Ether chapters 4, 5, and 12 for the lesson after the next one. The reading for next week is Ether chapters 1 through 3, 6 through 11, and 13 through 15. See you next time.